Thank you, Jaydeep, for that wonderful introduction. I've been a part of the India Inclusion Summit for 2014 when I hosted the dinner, and 2015 when I also hosted the fundraising dinner. And I feel a part of the India Inclusive Summit. So when family members praise you, you feel very, very jittery. I remember I had gone to Kolkata to speak to the Institute of Company Secretaries National Conference, and I was there for 3 days. And at that time, I got a SMS from my son, who was 7 years at that time. And that SMS actually shook me, because then I realized what it means when you get praised by family members. The SMS of my son Pratyush read, "You are the best daddy in my whole family." And I was very confused because I thought I was the only daddy in his whole family. I immediately rushed back home. Thank God nothing hanky-panky was happening. From those days onwards, I've stopped going to outstation trips for more than 2 days. So thank you so much, Jaydeep, for that wonderful introduction. There's a beautiful saying which goes that the problem with understanding disability is the disability of understanding. And it's so very true, because when you think of disability, you have so many assumptions which come into your mind. I had gone to Coimbatore a few years back. I was called by the Institute of Chartered Accountants to speak to the CPT students doing their mercantile law, and they put me in a bus which reached Coimbatore the next day morning at 6 o'clock. It was a sleeper bus, and I was traveling alone, so I reached the next day in the morning at 6 o'clock in Coimbatore, and there was somebody who was supposed to come and pick me up at the bus stand. So when I reached there, I thought that there will be somebody, but unfortunately nobody was there. So I called up the organizers here and I said, "What has happened? Nobody's come to pick me up. It's already 6:15, 6:20. The bus has come at 6 o'clock. He told, "No, sir, there's a boy called Sunil. He's already there at 5:45. You might have got down at the wrong bus stand." I told, "No. The last bus stand, that's the place where I've got down." So he told, "Let me coordinate." He coordinated. He called me back. He told, "No, sir, you're in the wrong bus stand." I told, "No." I told him, "Give me the number of Sunil." I took the number of Sunil, called him up. And after a lot of haggling, finally at around 6:50, Sunil identified me and he came and he picked me up. While we were going to the lodge where they were putting me up, I asked Sunil, "See, I am visually impaired. I couldn't see you. We were in the same bus stop for the last 50 minutes and you couldn't identify me. There is something seriously wrong here." He told, "No, sir, they told one blind person is coming, so I thought a person with cane, black spectacles, poor demeanor is there. How do I know blind people are so handsome, charming, whatever, yeah." Modesty is not my virtue, so you can. So we make such unclarified assumptions, and I wanted to title this talk itself, "The Assumptions Which We Make." I have a friend called Priya. She works as a loan officer in Canara Bank, and she was doing a counseling course in RV Road some years back. And she got down from her counseling course and she rang me up a few hours later. She told, "Rajdeep, do you know there was a man, he made me cross the road from RV Road from the other side to this side." I said, "But that's great, Priya, somebody helped you out." She told, "No, Rajdeep, but I didn't want to cross the road at all. But this man told, oh, you papa, you're standing outside. No, I'll help you out." And before I could protest, he dragged me from one side of the road to the other side. And that poor girl, that white cane, the tip which she had actually blew off. Correct. If that man hadn't made an assumption, he could have just asked her. And by just asking her a small question, "How do I help you?" he would have avoided all that rigmarole which actually happened. So we make so many assumptions which move from the sublime to the ridiculous, isn't it? There's a boy in my college, as he told you, I'm a coordinator in the Department of Commerce in Jain University, and there's a boy in my college who has a stuttering problem. He has a speech impairment, and he was that day in the corridor, and he was talking, I want to go to, and he got stuck over there. And there were 5 boys around him, and all of them are rushing to complete it. "You want to go to the bathroom? You want to go to the classroom? You want to go to the basement? You want to go to the library?" And that poor fellow, after listening to all of them, scratched his head and he said, "I forgot where I wanted to go." Correct? What is this? Can't you wait for a few minutes rather than making an assumption where a person wants to go? The most decent thing you could have done is wait for a person with speech impairment to complete what he had to complete, instead of rushing to conclusions and shouting at him at what you wanted to do. So just remember that you make unbelievable assumptions. I was the governing council member of a blind organization here, and there was a student in the hostel who was extremely good at music. He was a great singer, he was good at vocals, and one day, one of the volunteers was sitting next to this boy, and this boy gave a sneeze. Choo! And this lady shouted, "Oh my God, how musically he sneezes, yeah? How can a person sneeze musically?" Unless you're Vijay Prakash or Raghu Dikshit or something, I don't know. But whatever it is, but you cannot sneeze musically, but you make an assumption which actually doesn't come true. In fact, I had read a beautiful poem when I was in my 7th standards about the assumptions which we make in life. The poem goes like this. It's an anonymous poet. It goes like this. It says, "The spring blew a trumpet of color. Her green sang in my brain. I saw a blind man stumble, tap, tap with his cane. I pitied him in his blindness, but can I boast I see? Perhaps there's a spirit beside me who in fact pities me. Looks at my five-sense cane of mind. Among such unglessed glories, I am worse than blind." There are so many glories in this world, and you make such unclarified assumptions. How do you boast, you see? There are the ultraviolet, the infrared. There are so many beautiful pieces of nature which we cannot see. And just because of this five-sense cane of mind, you make such assumptions. In fact, Patanjali in this Yoga Sutra says that there are three types of logical assumptions which we make. The tarka, the kutarka, and the vitarka. Tarka and kutarka, I'll talk together. Don't worry about the Sanskrit word. Tarka and kutarka stands for plain logic and fraud logic. Let me combine both of them because of sparsity of time. When you make a fraud logic or a plain logic, it doesn't work all the time. It absolutely doesn't work all the time. It's just like saying, "I love my teacher and my teacher loves his daughter, so I love my teacher's daughter." Does it make sense? Or means for you all it's better. "I love my neighbor and my neighbor loves his wife, so I love my neighbor's wife," or whatever you want to call it. Correct? So it doesn't make sense. Logic can take you from place A to B, but imagination can take you everywhere. And what I'm trying to tell you is tarka and kutarka doesn't work. When I was trying for a job after my gold medal in MCOM in Mysore University, I was thrilled. I thought I'm going to get a job easily. But every single college I went to always said, "Oh my God, commerce, how are you going to teach on the board? How are you going to write debit and credit? How are you going to manage the class? What are you going to do?" They were working from a logic which is absolutely plain. And it doesn't work all the time. After 17 rejections, when I finally got the job, I figured out a way of teaching commerce. I teach income tax, I teach financial management, I teach account. It doesn't mean that when I'm teaching those subjects, I don't write. I take the student with the best handwriting in the class to write on the board, and they do the writing. So there's no complaint. There is absolutely no complaint about my bad handwriting on the board. They have to just see what is written on the board. I have to do the explanation. It doesn't mean that the person with visual impairment has to write on the board. If I have to speak, explain to them income from salary, or if I have to teach them a debit and credit, it doesn't mean. But your logic will defy that. That is tarka and kutarka, isn't it? There was a Quizmaster who backed out from my college event around 7 years back. There was an important intercollegiate quiz event which was supposed to happen. It was called Spurti for the second PUC and first PUC students. And everybody said, "Oh my God, how are we going to get a quiz master?" And I'm very fond of quizzing. I've been a quizzer all my life in my 10th standard, 11th and all that. And I said, "I will be the quiz master." "Oh no, how can you be the quiz master? You can't see. What will you be able to manage? There'll be 5 teams on stage." I told, "No, I'll manage it." They told, no, we have to take permission from the principal. The principal told, "Rajdeep, how will you do it?" I said, "I've got a great memory, sir. 48 slides is not a problem. 6 teams, 8 rounds. I'll memorize the slides one after the other, and even there'll be audiovisual." He said, "Okay, Rajdeep, we can trust your memory, but we can't trust your steps. Suppose you fall off the stage." I told, sir, it will be great for you. For the first time, your quiz master will be in touch with the audience at least. Correct? So, he laughed about it and he gave me the chance to be the quiz master. And I've never looked back after that. I've hosted quizzes for Nokia, for Siemens, for every company. What has happened is we assume things. And that is the tarka and kutarka. But what Patanjali said was, move from your tarka and kutarka to a breakthrough logic, which is called vitarka. When you have a breakthrough logic, when you think, when you assume in a way which is positive, that is called as vitarka. And that's what I'm urging all of you all to do. When I lost my eyesight in my 8th standard and I was troubled, and many of the people used to come to my house and talk to my grandfather and said, oh, papa, tumhara pota aankh se chala gaya hai, wo kya karega zindagi mein? What is your grandson going to do? He doesn't have any eyesight. In those days, there were not many opportunities available. And every time my grandfather used to reply to them saying something which I want to tell you, he used to say, it doesn't matter if my grandson cannot see. Sometime, if doesn't matter if my grandson cannot see the world, there will be a day when the world will see my grandson. And that is, क्या हो गया अगर दुनिया को ये नहीं देख सकता है एक दिन ये भी आएगा जब दुनिया उसको देखेगी एंड आई यूज टू ऑलवेज से व्हाट एन अजम्पशन व्हाट अ पॉजिटिव अजम्पशन आई हैव टू लिव अप टू माय ग्रैंडफादर्स एक्सपेक्टेशंस एंड दैट इज व्हाट इज पॉजिटिव अजम्पशंस ऑल अबाउट इन फैक्ट हिस्ट्री इज रिप्लीट विद एग्जाम्पल्स ऑफ पीपल हु हैव मेड पॉजिटिव अजम्पशंस अबाउट पीपल एंड दे हैड टर्न्ड देयर लाइफ व्हाट वॉज एल्बर्ट आइंस्टाइन टिल ही वॉज 12 इयर्स ओल्ड एन एब्सोल्यूट रिडिक्यूलस पर्सन ही कुडंट टॉक ही वॉज लेबल्ड एज डम्ब The teacher of his class wrote to his mother saying that your son is doomed for life. But what did the mother reply back? She replied back saying, that's your opinion, not mine. She continuously reposed faith in Albert Einstein. And today we have one of the greatest scientists we've ever come across because somebody made a positive assumption. What was Helen Keller? Deaf, dumb, blind, and everybody had written off her as a wild cat. She was ferocious, but there was some miracle worker called Anne Sullivan who reposed faith in her and had a positive assumption that this girl can do something in life. And what happened was a transformation from a caterpillar to a butterfly to one of the greatest literary figures we have ever come across. What I'm trying to tell you is a simple thing. Yeah, I know. The bell is there for me to stop. Doesn't matter. I'll stop. You know, means I'd gone to a college and there was this speech which I went on, and when they had to thank me, they came on stage and they said, Rajdeep is a very balanced speaker. What he lacks in depth, he makes up in length. So don't worry. So, I'm going to stop. Just this last line. So just my urge to you is, go from tarka and kutarka to vitarka. There's a beautiful hoarding outside the Kempegowda International Airport in Bangalore by a real estate property holder. I had asked somebody to read it. It said, you have landed, but have you arrived? And I want to ask you the same question. You have landed at IIS, but have you arrived? You will arrive only when you make the positive assumptions. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you very much.